Hi, this is Greg once again for our weekly SPY update. We'll take a little look behind, a little look forward. I do make these in TradingView and publish them to YouTube. So if you follow YouTube, if you don't mind hitting a like and a subscribe, it helps me understand if people are watching this. I'm not at a level I make any money or anything. If you watch this on TradingView, a couple things. If you hit the little boost button, and also you can subscribe to me there, and you can catch these weekly. The nice thing about TradingView is as well, I can post the static charts, and I will put a link to those, the ones that I particularly think are important right now, and some that I put that were a ways back, and they actually do a bar replay. So that's kind of cool. You should check that out. That being said, let's jump into it. So on the monthly charts, those of you who follow me for a while will remember that I do run the uptrend. This white channel is the pre-COVID uptrend, the longest bull market ever, whatever they called it. Then you can see COVID hit here. Again, this is monthly, so it's a little distorted, but this is a big drop. And then our blow-off top recovery, which was all fueled by, you know, tax money, unfortunately. So that being said, I fibbed it out as well because I usually expect them to come down to the 618, which is ironically right at the bottom of that trend line, and also would put it probably back into better forward earnings. Because right now, if you look at like the NASDAQ, and I actually have a screen pop of that, the NASDAQ and the S&P 500, the forward PEs, the current PEs are way too high. They have come down a lot for the last year, but you know, S&P 500 still in the, I want to say 19s, and we need that to get down to 15, 16 to be more of the means. And I think we'll probably overshoot that a little. One of my mentors on Reading the Market, that's another great chat group. He's saying that, you know, probably overshoot into the 14s, which would probably put us down towards that 618 retracement. And when, you know, we're looking at 300 SPY, 3000 SPX there, I've been seeing some 2800 estimates lately. So that's kind of a monthly quick one. You're going to lose my picture here. Not that I'm pretty. Not bad. A little bit. Okay. Never mind. For some reason, it doesn't go from tab to tab. So I'm going to jump into this weekly again. Same kind of pre-COVID uptrend. Here it's a little more defined. The big COVID, I was on vacation that week. It was awful. Or that couple of these weeks. These are weekly bars, remember? And then, try to freak out trade on your mobile phone once when you're on vacation. Probably some of you have done that. Anyway, I fibbed this out. They line up with the other ones, so you're looking at a 310 on the 618 retrace. What I do find interesting is it did bounce off the 50% retrace, and I think that's not totally uncommon too. I shouldn't say right off of, but close. This pink line right here is an anchored VWAP off the beginning of 2020. Monday 3 January 2022. So that's the peak of the market. So this is all of 2022 and then year to date 2023. And really what that's showing is the price volumes, where if you're below that line, you're not in the money. And I don't mean that in an options way. But when you get above it, you're doing well. Now, one thing I find interesting is we've, you know, tested this uptrend multiple times and then broke through, came back and retested. I'm gonna have to extend this line, and are now back up to fighting with this VWAP, right? Anchored VWAP. So this is an interesting thing, or maybe it's just a retest of this upper trend line. I'm not totally sold on this channel I drew here, but we'll see how it plays out, because if it comes back inside there and goes up, you know, I don't know, we're duck billing here again. On the MACD, so that could go either way. We're middling on the RSI, that could go either way. Here's what scares me right here. The debt ceiling deadline, 6 June 23. What that means is that would be an awfully good trigger to get the VIX over 40 and cause a recession right there. And so I put that on there and said, look out. So that's on a weekly. Let me jump to a daily. Look at that, another freaking if you look at the daily and I zoom out, you really see the downtrend. I'm sorry about the amount of detail, but again, I use the same technical drafting where the channel's in the white channel. So it just gets more and more and more detailed the shorter the time frames get. And on the daily, I do a little better job notating what's happening, what days. So as you can see on this one, again, we're looks to me like we got into this channel and are retesting it. And this is just a microcosm of the earlier expanding wedges. So anyway, kind of looks bullish. It doesn't make sense to me why it is. Intraday, for those of you that care, we don't really cover that much in this. So let's jump into what I'm seeing on the macro, right? First of all, I want to point out where we sit today, looking at the next Fed meeting, because as Feds increase rates, that's negative. It's a headwind for equities, right? And so it's very important for us to know where they're sitting and where the market thinks they're sitting. And interestingly enough, the Fed just doesn't stop with what they keep repeating over and over is 2% and, you know, their dual mandate, and they're just not budging off that. There was confusion when Yellen talked at the same time as Powell, when they had contradictory statements about the FDIC insurance with that banking fiasco. But otherwise, they're pretty on track where the Feds are saying they're just going to keep raising rates till they get rid of inflation. Now, the market's disagreeing. But one thing I want to point out, this is a cool tool. If you do a compare, this bar here is literally Friday, and it's saying this is a pause. I should go back. I'm sorry. This is a pause next meeting, and this is a 25 basis point increase. When I do a compare, so our pause from Friday to today went from for 83% chance that we're going to have a pause in May all the way down to 56% in literally one day. That's a pretty big change. Another thing I'll point out here, this part is the probabilities of even future further rate hikes or cuts. So it's saying basically 55% chance of staying where we are all the way through into June. Now remember what I just told you was happening in June as far as the debt ceiling. But then they're already pricing in cuts. If you look at blue, that's where they anticipate the largest percentage likelihood of being. One thing I will point out is these aren't too far apart from each other, a pause and a cut. And even if you look at next month again, you know, they're not terribly far apart. So don't get tricked into just staring at the colors. But if you do just stare at the colors, it looks like they're going to go into a big, downshifting cycle and cutting cycle. I don't think that's what they're saying, but that's what the market's saying. Who's right? We're going to find out. Fear and greed. This started at about 35 today and it's ticking up. And I think that's because we had I don't want to call it a bullish day, but it was a better than terrible day. I'd like to see this go to extreme fear and buy because I'm a contrarian guy. If you look at our sectors year to date, one thing to notice is look at tech, 18% XLK. Communication service, 18%. Now remember, there's a lot of stuff in communication that's tech as well. But then on the downside, we've got energy. Now, what I have noticed is, I didn't want to do that. What I have noticed is this is very similar to some recession indicators as well from, if you look at historical analogs. Just a quick side note on this same screen. Look at NVIDIA, 83% up this year. Wish I would have bought that. Meta, 71%. Tesla, 54%. I did some swings on that, and I should have let my profits run. That was one of the rules from Marty Zweig, I think is his name. Let's see if I can find that. I'm trying to be a little entertaining here. So this is from 4/11/1990, Marty Zweig's investing rules. And I don't know who this is, but I guess it was a big name. A lot of the traders that have been around for a while have mentioned to me when I post this on our chat boards that yeah, they have high respect for them. Number one rule, don't fight the tape. Number six is don't fight the Fed. And then it says less valid than one. So that goes back to my point earlier. Who's right here? The Feds or the tape? Because the tape's saying we're getting cuts, which is bullish. If you want to look at, 5 days would include the day, so we're gonna be lacking one day. But we had a bit of a bullish week last week. You know, I guess, right? Let me see you on the weekly. Yep. You know, on this, these are weeklies. So this week we got rejected at the trend. So that's interesting. The economic calendar, personal income and outlays. This is the PCE report on Friday. That's huge. If you look down here at the legend, the red markers are the most important. The greens are, and it goes down in that order. But for me, PCI is the biggest thing on here. Jobless claims. Once we start seeing jobless, you know, the people getting on more unemployment is another indication we're heading to towards recession. I wonder if that's going to start happening. I've heard rumors the Fed is willing to let it go up to 4.6% unemployment to get sticky inflation unsticky and get down to the 2% goal. Also, GDP, that's been holding actually steady at 3.2%. Do I have that on here? I did. I must have closed it. So anyway, the GDP is 3.2%. I'm losing my spot. Anyway, quarter one is 3.2%. It will be, you have one more revision on Friday, which is the last day of the month. I'm surprised it's that high. Again, that sounds bullish to me as well. Yeah. All right. We talked about PE ratios. I like to watch the index PE ratios because I'm an ETF buyer, honestly. And that's why I watch the SPY too. So the S&P 500 index, 17.72. I mean, historical norms are probably closer to the 15-ish, 16-ish range. You think, well, that's getting close. I go, yeah, considering last year was 24. But when you look at their forward projections, it's 17.75. So I don't know. It's odd. And I find it odd that on the NASDAQ, it's also still very close a year from now. So they're saying a year from now, we're not going to be anywhere. Okay, we've had those kind of years, but it seems odd, especially coming off of a PE ratio a year ago of 33 to 25. So I find that interesting. We don't want to look at that. I want to jump back into some of my charts here, and I got them out of order. Canary in a coal mine, Dow Jones Trust. Okay, it's holding at support. If we go back to our October lows, you know, technically we're still in an uptrend. Some weakness, but look at the MACD rolling. We've gotten to oversold. Well, not oversold, but we're low on the RSI. So that's looking a little bullish. IWM is small caps, also has a lot of the regional bank stuff in it, interestingly. It seems to be holding support fairly well. Again, the MACD's bottomed out. We're going upwards on the RSI. It's a little bullish, right? SPY, oh, we talked plenty about that. Qs, I mean, again, they've had a good run this year, but got to remember on this chart, that's starting right here. So again, that's that. This is going to be rough, but you know, 20%. So that's why you hear, oh, this year the NASDAQ's in a bull market. Well, what I see up here though is RSI's topping out, MACD's over. Yeah, there's room to run. Maybe it'll jump up to here yet, 330. But then I think it's going to give back some stuff, especially if interest rates start to climb again. We'll get into that. I'm trying not to miss too much. The VIX, I don't know, this pattern, this doesn't even look like a pattern to me. It looks just like volatility, honestly. So the 10-3 month on the inverted yield curve just keeps looking worse. And I believe this is the best indication of recession that I'm looking at. The 10-2 also not looking good. looks like it's recovering, but I believe this is the wonkiness in the banks where the 2-year went down, the 10-year. So some weird stuff happened when those banks freaked out. Growth versus value. Growth shot up, you know, when we were doing real well. Now you see value taking back over. Again, Fed funds rate. Again, this looks just volatile. Like, it doesn't know what way he's got to go up or down or what's going on. Bond volatility index. Now, here's something that you almost, the move, people don't even know about this one, the move index. It's the VIX of bonds. Oops, get that back scaling. You know, look at this. Bonds are just freaking out. But on the same point, look at the 2-year, look at this 3-month, 4.7. The 10-year, 3.5. Look at the increases today. I mean, we're talking 5-6% increases in a day in bonds. That's insane. It's just insane. So anyway, mortgage rates. Okay, they give back a little. I will say I saw today that it actually went up 16 basis points. I believe this is close of Friday, Thursday the 23rd. Might even be a week behind. Oil and gas up nicely. Gold is losing a little, so people are maybe pulling back out of their hedges. Wheat's up 1.3%. Natural gas taking a beating, down 5%. Lumber down 4%. I think that's good because I'm in the real estate business. Let's look at some banking stuff. Banking, you know that's been in trouble, but it caught support and it's holding it. And it sure does look like it bottomed to me. And this definitely went oversold. Same with the KRE, which is the regional banks, which are the ones that are everybody's the most afraid of. I did think it would come down and do this, hit this gap fill. Stupid trading view. Real close. I mean, maybe you could call it a rounding error. There on a daily, it's probably a little bit further off than I like. Look at the volume. Look at the volume the last couple days. So people are buying this dip. No doubt about it, man. Anyway, so that's what I have for you today. I'm trying to think if I missed anything. Again, if you don't mind liking and subscribing, TradingView and YouTube, I'll keep producing these videos. I'm trying to keep them shorter, but they always seem to go almost the whole 20 minutes, which is the limit on TradingView. I do have some software to make these videos a little better as far as pretty, but I don't know if I can get them from YouTube to TradingView, because I would post them on YouTube if I did that. So if you have any questions, please feel free to leave comments. I love to hear back from anybody. And thanks for watching. And again, like and subscribe. Thanks, and have a great week and lucky trading to you all. Friday's going to be exciting.